What do you have there?
I don't know.
Something. I think it's a caterpillar.
A caterpillar? I think it's a butterfly.
It's a caterpillar.
It's a caterpillar, definitely.
Butterflies go like that.
Well, you're right. But you know what? This caterpillar is going to turn into a butterfly soon.
How?
You know what? I'm not sure. And when scientists aren't sure, you know what they do?
What?
Well, they try to find out. So I think, this guy doesn't get away. I think I'll call a friend of mine. I have a friend named Professor Puccini, who's an expert on butterflies. Why don't I give her a call? Buongiorno, Professor Puccini. Hi, this is Mr. Wizard. How are you? Good. I'm fine, too. Thanks. Hey, we have a problem over here at the lab. Some of the kids brought in a caterpillar, and we're not exactly sure what happens to it so that it becomes a butterfly. How long? We need to wait 10 or even 12 days? Well, okay. You think you can come over in about 10 or 10, 12 days and help explain to us what happened? Oh, that's great.
Hello, Mr. Wizard.
Hi, Amy. Hi, Mark. Look, can you see what I've got here? Look, that caterpillar turned into a butterfly.
But do you know how it did it yet?
Still don't know what happened. I watched it. Oh, maybe that's the professor. Maybe she can help us.
Amy. How are you?
Professor Puccini, welcome. Glad to see you.
Nice to meet you.
Okay, you know Amy and Mark. Mark's got a chair for you there. And this was that caterpillar I was telling you about. It's now turned into what?
A beautiful monarch butterfly.
Wow. And he's been stretching his wings. But before he was a butterfly, he was in this little green, is that a cocoon?
Yes, it is a cocoon. It's called a chrysalis, and that's where he forms his beautiful colors before he hatches out.
And I think we could still see in there what's left of the cocoon. It looks like a little skeleton almost.
Yes, we can.
Just a dried up cocoon. And he's been stretching his wings, I guess, now that he's free, that he's loose from that. Looks like he's ready to fly. Should we just let him go?
Well, we should let him go. We should take him outside and let him go.
Yeah, but he'll freeze.
Well, he won't freeze because he isn't going to stay in this area. He's going to fly to Mexico.
Mexico? That's about 1,000,000 miles away.
Well, it's almost 2,000 miles. And then he will live in the Mexican rainforest.
But on the way, won't he starve?
No, because he'll stop and he'll tank up and have a feeding on the nectar of the sweet flowers, and then he'll fly several more days before he stops and rests again.
Wow. And then will he ever come back to our area?
This butterfly won't ever come back, No. But he has left his eggs behind him before he goes.
Oh, I see. And then that's why in the spring we'll have more?
We'll have more monarch butterflies who will eat the milkweed pod.
Oh, okay.
And then they will make new chrysalises.
Great. Hey, let's take him outside and let him go. It's a nice day, and we'll start watching him fly to Mexico. Good idea?
Okay.
I think it's really time to let the butterfly go. Mark, gently lift the screen off the front. There she is. There she goes.
Bye-bye.
There it is.
Look, she's stuck in the tree up there. Next to
you. Do they stay in Mexico?
Yes, they do stay in Mexico.
Written by Gilbert and Sullivan.
I am the captain of the Pinafore,
and a right good captain too.
The HMS Pinafore waits in the cafeteria during the Arts Festival just for you.
If you want to experience the excitement on a ship of the British Royal Navy, and if you want to see which one of us marries Little Buttercup, then come to our production of the HMS Pinafore in the cafeteria Thursday night, June 12th at 8 o'clock.
For he is an Englishman, for he himself has said it, and it's greatly to his credit that he is an Englishman. He remains an Englishman.
What in the world?
It's been a long day. I think I'll pour myself a drink.
How did he do that?
I sure don't know.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Early in the morning we'll be starting out. The money will be coming along. We're loading up already with the boats inside and heading out singing.
go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
The 5th and 6th graders from Burnell Campus School in Bridgewater took a trip on May 14th and 20th, 1986, to Barney's Joy, a barrier beach in South Dartmouth. The trip was part of our science class's study of ecology. When we arrived, Sandy, one of our guides, explained that Barney's Joy is part of the Lloyd Center, an area by the ocean shore that has four different habitats, an estuary, a salt marsh, a beach, and sand dunes. This is the story of our field trip.
The estuary. An estuary is a habitat where fresh water meets salt water. To examine the estuary at Barney's Joy, some of our group members put on the waders so they could go into the water to sand without getting wet. Sanding is using a long net with floats on the top and weights on the bottom. The sanding net catches plants and animals that live in the water. Sane is French for net. Here's Johnny Ching describing the seining process.
We're seining over here, and it's you're dragging a net along the against the current to pick up small animals that are in the water. We had to seine three times because we didn't catch many animals.
We found mummy chogs, flounder, and a pipefish. We also saw periwinkles, which we were able to identify as a Gulf periwinkle using the guidebook. We also found barnacles and the inside of a dead green crab. Here is Rob describing one of our most exciting things we discovered, two horseshoe crabs mating.
These little almost like claws. Well, actually, they are claws. And that's how it clasps onto the back of the female. And what they'll do is they'll burrow into the sand here, and they'll stay attached for sometimes days until they're completed with their mating. And sometimes it takes a long time, but I'm glad someone picked it out because I haven't started seeing them yet, but that means we could be seeing even more and more of them pretty soon.
What happens when they turn over?
What happens when they turn over?
If they can't get over?
Actually, they can get back up. What they do is they'll stick their tail here back into the sand and turn themselves over. And it's a kind of neat to watch, but we're going to put these back in.
How long can they stay up for?
Oh, they can't stay out for long because what happens when they stay out?
They dry out.
That's right, they dry out. And these animals need to be wet as they breathe underwater.
Now Rob describes a sand shrimp that one of our classes found.
Okay, it says they are, however, an important diet of fish. So what does that mean here? What is the fish? So fish are what? Predators on sand shrimp? This is a sand shrimp. A sand shrimp. It is one, and let me see your drawing. All right, sketch. Okay, special characteristics. What is a special characteristic? Where was it found?
Sand and rocks.
So a sandy or rocky bottom. Okay, so you can put that down. Well, what was on its back?
Green dots.
No, it's dots. That's right. What are those dots? What are those dots mirror? What are they?
Pregnancy.
No, what do they make it look like?
Egg.
No, what are the dots on its back make it look like? Where does it live?
Oh, it makes it look like little rocks.
Exactly, our sand. So it blends in with its environment. So you can put that down.
So
it blends.
Hide from fish.
Exactly, so it can hide from predators.
First bridge we saw won the overall competition of both aesthetics and strength. But we're going to add some additional weight today. These ones tied with the winner. And we're going to see which one's really the strongest one of all. I think we're ready to let the contest begin. We'll cross our fingers and hope for the best. If we could start with the small sea clamps. We'll want to put two on. Place them carefully. Has to be over the open span, over this open area here we're trying to fill. Okay, I'll just help you with that if we could. And we'll go for two more sea clamps. I'll have to be in this open span area. You might try to use those parts that come down from the sea clamp to help it stay in place. Okay, I guess we have one final sea clamp to put on. Both bridges seem to be holding up quite well. We don't see very much sag yet. We can try laying one more on and see what happens. Matt's getting clever here. He's putting it lengthwise across, distributing the weight. Okay, we're Oh, well, we have some champions here. We have some fine runners-up who had a splendid design, a very original design. And may we congratulate this team here.
Oh, hi. My name is Matthew Wozuck. I'd like to talk to you about something very important. Homework. Oh, yes. Let me introduce Ralph. Ralph thinks he knows everything. I do know everything. I do. Yeah, right. Well, anyway, most kids hate homework. After working all day in school, the last thing they want to do at home is work. But when you think about it, homework is good for you. Even my bird does homework. Nuts! Now, listen. Homework is work. We do at home to practice what we learned in school. So homework is practice. Right. And we all know. Larry Bird loves to homework. Now, practice. It might be easier if you do homework at the right time and in the right way. For instance, you don't want to do homework too late at night. Wake up. Or with the TV or radio on. Unless they give you the answers. No, the best way to do homework is alone, so you can concentrate. Right, Ralph?
Yep.
So remember, homework is practice, just as you practice soccer and dancing. And playing a musical instrument. You should do your homework because homework is practice. Right.